Here's a graph the proponents of minimum wage pseudoscience keep throwing my way. It's yet another study purporting to show that there are no disemployment effects of the minimum wage. I've covered this at length in other videos. In particular, see why many minimum wage studies are bogus. I'm going to focus on this graph because it's what the minimum wage proponents keep throwing around, like John Schmidt of the Center for Economic and Policy Research, who said, "The estimated employment effects, which are displayed along the x-axis, include both negative and positive values. Following standard statistical procedures, however, the researchers have also weighted each estimate by its statistical precision, which is measured on the y-axis. The higher up an estimate is, the more precise it is." What is most striking about the chart is that all of the most precise estimates are at or very close to zero, the point where the minimum wage has no effect on teen employment. The first reason why this is bogus is that any meta-analysis should comprise the bulk of the studies. By far, the overwhelming majority of the studies show negative employment effects, just as classical economics predicts. The study's authors have their excuse already. On page 3, they say, "When there is no publication selection, estimates should vary randomly and symmetrically around the true population effect. Because small sample studies with typically less precision form the base of the graph, the plot will be more spread out there than at its top. Should the plot be overweighted on one side or the other, this is taken as evidence of publication selection. In figure 2, we have an obvious example of a skewed diagram that reflects publication selection." Oh, really? That's what it means. Publication bias. It couldn't possibly be because there actually are disemployment effects of minimum wage, and it's actually very difficult to get a positive employment effect no matter how badly you do the study, could it? Come on! They're engaging in the cardinal sin of science, starting with the conclusion and coming up with other reasons why the data don't fit. Think about it this way. I'm sure in pretty much any astrophysics journal you'd open, you'd find all sorts of studies with data showing the Earth to be round, and none at all to be flat. Making this kind of funnel graph would be very lopsided indeed. Are you really going to tell me that this would be evidence of publication bias, and not simply because the Earth is, in fact, round? The other reason why this is bogus is that they're asking you to just look at the graph and see how closely it converges to zero as you go up the graph to more and more precise values. By the way, don't confuse precise with statistically significant. Those are two different things. And in fact, there's an inverse relationship between the two. With the same data set, a statistically insignificant result can be made significant by decreasing precision. It sounds contradictory, but that's the way it is. The reason why is that the larger margin of error has a greater likelihood of being accurate. In other words, of the real value lying between the error bars. It's like if you shoot at a target and your shots are all close together, but far from the bullseye. You have good precision, but you're far from the mark. And keep in mind that we're talking about precision here because that'll be important later. Now, it really does look like these numbers are converging on zero, but that's because they have the line representing zero running up through the graph. Now, the authors didn't give out the raw data, at least in this study, so I couldn't reproduce the graph myself. The visual data is all they give us to go on. So I'll use Photoshop to remove that line corresponding to zero. I'm also giving some better resolution in the x-axis so you can see the marks by tenths instead of by quarters. Now, before we go any further, let's talk about what that x-axis is measuring. It's a quality called elasticity, which basically means how responsive the real world is to changing conditions. In this case, it's how responsive employment figures are to a change in minimum wage laws. A classic example you'll read about in economics books is elevator operators. Up until the early 1960s, elevators in many multi-floor businesses were operated by a full-time employee whose sole job was to make the elevator go up and down. I'm oversimplifying, of course. They had an intense responsibility to their passengers. Their skills at operating the elevator kept rides smooth, made sure there were no sudden jolts as the elevator accelerated or stopped, and they also had to make sure that the floor of the elevator lined up with the floor of that story so the passengers wouldn't trip and fall. They even had to keep track of which floor they were on and announce it to the passengers, since many elevators didn't even have indicators saying which floor you were on. As minimum wages rose, Elevator operators didn't lose their jobs, since it was really something they couldn't do without, until electronics came along and made them obsolete. So it wasn't the case that they raised the minimum wage on Monday and people were laid off on Tuesday. How quickly it happens depends on various factors. Generally, the least skilled jobs held by the least experienced workers go more quickly. Since elevator operators needed both skill and experience, they could hold on to their jobs for a while longer. This is why so many minimum wage researchers look at teenagers. Teens just entering the workforce for the first time are generally unskilled and inexperienced, so the elasticity of their jobs should be greatest, and the effects of the minimum wage felt there the most. Same with certain minorities such as African Americans who tend to have lower educational attainment. This is expressed as a number which is the ratio of the change of the causal factor to the effect change, in this case, the change in magnitude of the minimum wage to the change in unemployment. At the end of my earlier video, I gave the conclusion of Newmark and Washer's meta-study. A 10% increase in the minimum wage will reduce employment in vulnerable groups by 1% and overall by 0.04%. So if we look at vulnerable groups such as teens, a 1% unemployment increase from a 10% minimum wage increase is an elasticity of 0.1, and a 0.04% overall unemployment increase is an elasticity of 0.004. Since we're talking about disemployment effects, we need to express this as a negative elasticity, so it's actually negative 0.1 and negative 0.004. Now let's go back to the graph. Again, all we have to go on is visual, but in the absence of any vertical lines, it should be easy to draw a line showing where the visual convergence is. Here it is in blue. Now let's put back the line for zero. Ha! Do you see? Our line of best fit is lower than zero, meaning disemployment effects. Now you can say, well, that doesn't look like much to me, but remember that the authors have scaled this graph. Not only did they select the scale for the x-axis, they chose the overall width as well, which is less than 60% of the width of the page. The text and tables are far wider. They deliberately chose a much smaller width for the graphs. The important thing here is not to try to see what's going on visually, but to see what the actual elasticity is. Remember, according to the Newmark-Washer meta-study that this study's authors are trying to debunk, that's an elasticity of negative 0.1 for vulnerable groups. On page 11, they actually reveal the elasticity to be negative 0.19, plus or minus 0.001, almost twice as big as what Newmark and Washer predict. Of course, they blame publication bias for this, publication bias they have no evidence for whatsoever, but even after attempting to correct for it, they could only get the elasticity down to negative 0.054, more than half of the predicted amount. The effect is not zero, and zero is not even near the margin of error. Newmark wrote a response to this study in a 2015 article entitled, "The Effects of Minimum Wage on Employment," in which he said, "Some studies use meta-analysis, averaging across a set of studies to draw conclusions. For example, Dukuliagos and Stanley report an average elasticity across studies of negative 0.19, consistent with earlier conclusions, but argue that the true effect is closer to zero. They suggest that the biases of authors and journal editors make it more likely that studies with negative estimates will be published. However, without strong assumptions, it is impossible to rule out an alternative interpretation, that peer review and publication lead to more evidence of negative estimates because the true effect is negative. In addition, meta-analyses do not assign more weight to the most compelling evidence. Indeed, they often downweight less precise estimates, even though the lower precision may be attributable to more compelling research strategies that ask more of the data. In short, meta-analysis is no substitute for critical evaluation of alternative studies." There's also another invalid assumption here. Not only did they put forth no reason whatsoever as to why publications would be biased in favor of negative studies, they just look at the data and say it must be biased. In general, publication bias in science tends to go the opposite way. One reason for publication bias is that journals would rather publish studies that in some way go against the scientific consensus than studies that confirm it, since the prediction of classical economics as well as the long-standing consensus is for negative employment effects. If anything, the publication bias should be in favor of studies showing no or positive employment effects. Another reason for publication bias is financial interest or prejudice, and I don't think anyone can deny the interest of politicians commissioning minimum wage studies or the bias of the leftist neo-Keynesians that dominate public academia. Given all of this, the fact that there are so few studies they can point to confirm their hypothesis is actually pretty embarrassing. And yet, the authors claim on page 8, there is clear evidence of publication selection bias, yet there is no evidence of any minimum wage effect on employment. Yes, because they explained it all away with publication bias. And yet, even after their correction, they could only get it up to -0.054, which means the authors displayed unbelievable chutzpah for writing in their conclusion on page 23. Overall, correcting for publication bias would transform a modestly negative average elasticity to a small positive employment elasticity. Except it didn't, did it? You can only get it up to -0.054, which is not positive. Positive numbers aren't even within the margin of error. Not even zero is. In fact, the absolute lowest the disemployment effect could be, according to this margin of error, is -0.053. Are you all beginning to understand now why so many of us laugh at minimum wage proponents?